Now coming to the muscles of hand. They comes in three group. That is the muscles of the thumb, muscles of little finger, and the muscles of metacarpal bones. In the muscle of thumb, they are three in number. That is the abductor pollicis brevis, flexor pollicis brevis, and this red one is the opponens pollicis. Abductor pollicis brevis, it takes its origin from the tubercle of the scaphoid, crest of trapezium, and the flexor retinaculum. Flexor retinaculum is represented by this thin wire for the better visualization of the inner structure. Now this abductor pollicis brevis get inserted on the base of the proximal phalanx of the thumb on the radial aspect. Now this is the flexor pollicis brevis shown in the black color. It takes its origin from the flexor retinaculum and the crest of trapezium and get inserted on the base of the proximal phalanx of the thumb on the radial aspect, same as that of abductor pollicis. Now third one is the opponens pollicis. This red one, it takes origin from the flexor retinaculum and the crest of trapezium and get inserted on the radial border of the first metacarpal bone as well as the radial half of the palmar surface of first metacarpal bones. Now coming to the muscles of the little finger, they are abductor digiti minimi shown in the gray color, flexor digiti minimi shown in the black color, and opponens digiti minimi shown in the red color. This abductor digiti minimi, it takes its origin from the pisiform bone, piezohyoid ligament, tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris as well as the flexor retinaculum and get inserted into the base of the proximal phalanx of the little finger but towards the ulnar side. This flexor digiti minimi, it takes origin from the flexor retinaculum and the hook of Hammett and get inserted on the base of the proximal phalanx of the little finger towards the ulnar side. Okay, and this flexor digiti minimi, it has got an additional slip which get inserted into the tendon of extensor carpi ulnaris on the dorsal aspect. Okay, now this is the opponens digiti minimi. It takes its origin from the flexor retinaculum as well as the hook of Hammett and get inserted into the ulnar border of the fifth metacarpal bone here and as well as the ulnar half of the palmar surface of fifth metacarpal bone. Now coming to the muscles of the metacarpal bone, they are intraossei, that is the palmar intraossei and the dorsal intraossei, the lumbricals, and the adductor pollicis muscle. Okay, now first come to intraossei. There are three palmar intraossei but four dorsal intraossei. About the intraossei, there are certain common feature that it looks like earthworm. Lumbricals look like earthworm. Palmar intraossei and the dorsal intraossei both inserted on the extensor apparatus. Okay, and palmar intraossei are adductor, whereas the dorsal intraossei are abductor. Palmar intraossei, they are unipinnate in nature, whereas the dorsal intraossei are bipinnate in nature. Palmar intraossei 3 in number, dorsal intraossei 4 in number. But some research worker believe that the deep head of flexor pollicis brevis, this one is gray, one is the superficial head of the flexor pollicis brevis, and one is the deep head of flexor pollicis brevis, which is shown in this black wire, this one. And it starts from the takes origin from the base of the first metacarpal bone and insert on the proximal phalanx at the base but towards the ulnar side. This is the deep head of flexor pollicis brevis, and by some research worker it is taken as the first palmar intraossei. Okay, and now second palmar intraossei, it takes origin from the whole of the length of the metacarpal bone, not only the base, whole of the metacarpal, but towards the ulnar border and get inserted on the same side, that is the ulnar side, at the base of the proximal phalanx of index finger. And this is the third palmar introsei, this blue color, shown in this blue color, and it takes origin from the radial border of the fourth metacarpal bone and get inserted on the same side, that is the radial side. This is from the radial border of the fourth metacarpal and inserted on the radial side of the proximal phalanx of the fourth digit. Okay, and fourth palmar introsei, it takes origin from the radial border of the fifth metacarpal, and again the same side, that is the radial side, it insert on the base of the proximal phalanx of the little finger. This is, but the main insertion is on the extensor apparatus. As I have told earlier, that the both palmar and dorsal introsei also inserted on the extensor apparatus, which is formed by the extensor tendon of extensor digitorum, this green color, extensor digitorum, as well as the extensor indicis, this gray color, by extensor indicis tendon, as well as the extensor digiti minimi, shown in this white color, as well as the transverse metacarpal ligament. All this unite to form the extensor apparatus on the dorsal aspect. So it also get inserted there, this palmar introsei. And one thing more, that the palmar introsei, it starts with letter P and also palm tree. It looks like a palm tree, diverging leaves of the palm tree. Okay. Now coming to the dorsal introsei, they are four in number and all are bipinnate. It arises, as the name introsei means, in between the two bones. So it takes origin from the adjacent side of the metacarpal bone. This is the first dorsal introsei, and adjacent side of the first and second metacarpal bone, and get inserted on the base of the proximal phalanx of index finger, and the also inserted on the extensor apparatus. After uniting with the this gray wire, this is from lumbricals. After taking a common tendon of the dorsal introsei and the lumbricals, going to the extensor tendon. Okay. Or from the adjacent side of the metacarpal bone. And they are, they look like D for dorsal introsei and D for dia. Like a flame of a dia, they are converging. Okay. One thing here worth mentioning, that the proximal phalanx of thumb and the little finger has no attachment of introsei muscle on the dorsal side. And here one thing worth mentioning, that the middle finger has no attachment of palmar introsei on the palmar side. Okay. Now coming to the lumbricals. This is shown by this sky blue paper. They are four in number. Lumbricals. It looks like earthworm. Okay, lumbricals. And they have also got a special feature, because they have no bony attachment. It starts from a tendon and it ends in the tendon. So lumbrical, the first and second lumbricals, they are unipinnate, but the third and fourth are bipinnate, that the muscle fiber run in two direction. Okay, and it takes origin from the tendon of the flexor digitorum profundus. This yellow one is the flexor digitorum profundus. I have not glued here so that the inner structure should be visible. So it starts, it is adhered at the flexor digitorum profundus. It takes its origin and get inserted on the extensor apparatus on the dorsal aspect. Okay, and one thing, L for lumbrical and L for lateral side, they are all the lumbricus attaches to the extensor side from the lateral aspect. Lateral aspect means that's towards the thumb. This gray wire, it shows the insertion of the lumbricus, and they are coming from the radial side, from the lateral aspect. Okay. Now, the last muscle is the adductor pollicis. This black wire is the adductor pollicis. It makes a cube here, na? It's a, because it takes origin from the fore structure, that is the base of the second and third metacarpal bone, as well as from the capitate and the trapezoid. See, looks too pretty, try to catch. So this is trapezoid and this is capitate, and the base of the second and third metacarpal, and get inserted into the base of the proximal phalanx of thumb towards the ulnar side. And this is the transverse head, which arises from the distal 2/3 of the third metacarpal bone, and get inserted on the base of the proximal phalanx of the thumb towards the ulnar side. So this is about the adductor pollicis muscle. So this is about the muscles of the hand, but there are many clinical significance of this. First is the foment sign. In the foment sign, what we do, just we give command to the patient that approximate your ulnar side, ulnar border of your hand, of your two hand, like this, and just hold a thick paper or card like this. And if he is able to do, then his adductor pollicis muscle is okay. But if he flex the thumb, that it shows that the action of the adductor pollicis is taken over by the flexor pollicis longus tendon. Okay, adductor pollicis is doing adduction of the thumb, and the patient, if it is okay, the patient can hold like this. And if adductor pollicis is not working, it is done by the flexion of the interphalangeal joint of the thumb, which is done by flexor pollicis longus tendon. So it is compensated by the action of flexor pollicis longus. This is called Frohman's test. Okay. Now, many thing about the clinical significance, I have discussed already, that is the carpal tunnel syndrome and the dupuytren's contracture. And one thing more, that is the mallet finger. Mallet finger is what? Mallet finger, when the this is the extensor tendon, and here it is attached on the base of the proximal phalanx. Its lateral slip is going to insert here. But in baseball player, due to the prolonged use of holding of baseball, the extensor tendon get ruptured, and which lead to the unable to extend the terminal phalanx, unable to extend at the distal interphalangeal joint. The person is able to extend metacarpophalangeal joint as well as the proximal interphalangeal joint, but extension of distal interphalangeal joint is not possible due to the rupture of this tendon, and this will lead to the flexion of this, and which is look like a hammer. That's why this is called mallet finger or hammer finger. And if this is the mallet finger. Now, what is trigger finger? Trigger finger is the flexor pollicis, flexor deuterum profundus tendon and flexor deuterum superficialis. It glides within the fibrous flexor sheath very smoothly. But if there is a tenosynovitis of the of this area, there is a lump in the synovial sheath of the flexor deuterum profundus and flexor deuterum superficialis, and with the movement of the finger, it get obstructed at the level of A1. This is A1, A2, A3, A4, A5. There are 5 flexor sheath pulley. So it get obstructed during the movement of A1. And this is called the trigger finger. And the, if the patient try to extend their finger, there is a snap sound occur, a clicking sound occur with the forced extension of the finger. That is called the trigger finger. And tenosynovitis, that is the inflammation of the tendon as well as the synovial sheath, if it occurs at the region of the anatomical snub box, this is our anatomical snub box. Here is the anatomical snub box. And if tenosynovitis occurs at this place, where the synovial sheath covering the abductor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis, it get inflamed, this tenosynovitis is called decurvans tenosynovitis. Okay. And there are many compression neuropathy, like median nerve compression neuropathy in carpal tunnel syndrome, in the cubital tunnel syndrome, in which there is a tendinous arch in between the humeral head and the ulnar head of the flexor carpi ulnaris, in which the ulnar nerve get compressed. That is called the cubital tunnel syndrome. And in pronator teres syndrome, there is median nerve compression in between the humeral, ulnar and the radial head of the pronator teres. Okay. And like that in the radial nerve get also obstructed in between the head of the supinator. That is called the Frohse syndrome. Okay, so these are all about the clinical significance. And one thing more, the scaphoid, this is pisiform, this is hook of Hammett, this is scaphoid. The fracture of scaphoid, it occurs at the region of waist. There is proximal fragment, distal fragment and waist. Waist means the constricted region in between the proximal and distal. That is the common site of the fracture of scaphoid. And the scaphoid is supplied by, in 70 to 80% cases, by the retrograde dorsal branch of the radial artery. And when it gets fractured, it is supplied by the retrograde blood circulation, the proximal fractured part gets avascular necrosis will be there. Often asked in the exam, ki which segment get affected by the compromise in the blood supply to the scaphoid. So it is the proximal segment get necrosed, as it is supplied by the retrograde pathway by the radial artery, branches of the radial artery. Okay. Now, this is all about the hand anatomy. Thank you.